that are in all your celebrated operas. The swallow, the moth, the bee, the ship, the flower, etc. Besides, I have a prison scene which the ladies always reckon charmingly pathetic. I hope I may be forgiven, for I have not made my opera throughout unnatural like those in vogue, for I have no recitative. Otherwise, it must be allowed an opera in all its forms. Through the whole piece, you may observe such a similitude of manners in high and low life that it is difficult to determine whether, in the fashionable vices, the fine gentleman imitate the gentleman of the road, or the gentleman of the road the fine gentleman. Oh, it also carries with it a most excellent moral. It shows that the lower sort of people have their vices in a degree as well as the rich, but that they are punished for them. Come, play away the overture.
Thank you. A lawyer is an honest employment. So is mine. Like me too, he acts in a double capacity, both against rogues and for them. For it is befitting we should protect and encourage cheats, since we live by them.
Tom Gaster is found guilty! The lazy dog! This is death without reprieve. I may venture to book him for Tom Gag, £40. Let Betty Sly know that I will save her from transportation, for I can get more by her staying in England. I love to let women escape. The good sportsman always lets the hen partridges fly, for the breed of the game depends upon them. Besides, there is nothing to be got from the death of women except our wives.
Without dispute, she is a fine woman. It was to her that I was obliged for my education. She hath trained up more young fellows to the business than the gaming tables.
Truly, Filch, thy observation is right. We and the surgeons are more beholding to women than all the professions besides.
Tis woman that sits horses on her mind, by heavy voice which are the winning odds. Her very eyes can cheat when more she's blind. She tricks us on our money.
Between the skin and the old hair, she never saw.
Dickens is a woman always a whimpering about murder for? Murder is as fashionable a crime as a man can be guilty of. So, my dear, have done upon the subject. Was Captain Macheath here this morning?
Yes, my dear. Sure, there is not a finer gentleman upon the road than the captain. Pray, my dear, is the captain rich?
The captain keeps too good company to ever grow rich. Marylebone and the chocolate house are his undoing.
Really? I am sorry, upon Polly's account, the captain hath not more discretion.
Upon Polly's account? What a plague does the woman mean, upon Polly's account?
Captain Macheath is very fond of the girl.
And what then?
If I have any skill in the ways of women, I am sure Polly thinks him a very pretty man.
And what then? You would not be so mad to have the wench marry him. Gamesters and highwaymen are generally very good to their whores, but they are very devils to their wives.
But if Polly should be in love, how should we help her? Or how can she help herself? Poor girl, I am in the utmost concern about her.
Material will make but a poor hand of her beauty and soon be thrown upon the common.
sure he believes her a fortune. Do you think that your mother and I should have lived comfortably so long together had we ever been married? Oh, baggage.
I knew she was always a proud slut, and now the witch has played the fool and married. Can you support the expense of a husband, hussy, in gaming, drinking, and whoring? If you must be married, could you introduce nobody into our family but a hangman?
Let not your anger, my dear, burst through the rules of decency. Tell me, hussy, are you ruined or no?
With Hussy's fortune, she might very well have gone off to a person of distinction. Yes, that you might, you pouting slut!
What? Is the wench dumb? Speak, or I will make you squeal by squeezing out an answer from you. Are you really bound wife to him? Or are you only a pawn liking?
Can love be controlled by advice? Will Cupid a mother's obey? Though my heart were as frozen as ice, and his flame would have melted away. When he kissed me so closely he pressed, 'twas so sweet the time must have come.
Husband, that Captain McKeith is worth money. I am in doubt whether he hath not two or three section or two, Polly's dower was coming to dispute.
This indeed is a thought that is worthy of consideration. Lawyers are bitter enemies to those in our way. They do not care that anyone should get a clandestine livelihood but themselves. A fox may steal your hens, for your health and pence, sir. Your daughter from your chest, sir. Your wife may steal your rest, sir. A thief your goods and plate, your plate. A thief your goods and plate. But this is all but kitchen, with rest, with chest and kitchen.
Maybe. For I find in the romance you lent me, none of the great heroes were ever false in love.
My heart was so free, it rolled like a bee to Polly, my passion required. My heart was so free, it rolled like a bee to Polly, my passion required. I see him each flower, I change every heart. I see him each flower, I change every heart. But here every flower is united. But here every flower is united. Or any woman from Quadrille. But to tear me from thee is impossible.
Oh, my God.
So it seems his time has come.
But the present time is ours, and nobody alive hath more. Why are the laws leveled at us? Are we more dishonest than the rest of mankind? What we win, gentlemen, is ours by the law of arms and the right of conquest.
Where shall we find such another set of practical philosophers who to a man are above the fear of death?
Sound men and true.
Of trying courage and indefatigable industry.
Who is there here that would not die for his friend?
Who is there here who betray him for his interest?
So many things of courtiers I can say as much.
We are for a just partition of the world, for every man hath the right to enjoy life.
We retrench the superfluities of mankind. The world is avaricious, and I hate avarice. A covetous fellow like a jackdaw steals what he was never meant to enjoy for the sake of hiding it. These are the robbers of mankind, for money was meant for the free-hearted and generous. And where is the injury of taking from another what he has not the heart to make use of?
Our several stations for the day are fixed. Good luck, attend us all. Fill the glasses.
Fill every glass.
Hark, I can hear the sound of coaches, the hour of attack of Rome.
There's nothing that bends the mind like him. Money is not so strong a cordial for the time. Dear Mrs. Coaxer, you are welcome. You charm me today. I hope you do not want to repairs of quality and they are finished. Dolly Troll, kiss me, you slut.
Indeed, who cheats a woman?
Lace, madam, lies in small compass and is of easy conveyance. You are apt, madam, to think too well of your friends. If any woman hath more art than another, to be sure, it is Jenny Diver. Though her fellow be never so agreeable, she can pick his pocket as coolly, as if money were her only pleasure. Now that is a command of the passions uncommon to a woman.
Indeed, I never go to the tavern but in the view of business. I have other hours and other sort of men for my pleasure. But had I your address, madam.
And done with your compliments, ladies, and drink about. You are not so fond of me, Jenny, as you used to be.
'Tis not convenient, sir, to show my fondness among so many rivals. It is your own choice, and not the warmth of my inclination, that will determine you.
Before the border crowing, the cup my hands attending, his eyes around him throwing, stands for a while suspended. Then one he singles from the crew, and she is the happy hen. Now how do you do, and how do you do, and how do you do again?
How do you do, and how do you do, and how do you do, and how do you do?
Indeed, madam, if I had not been a fool, I might have lived very handsomely with my last friend. But upon his missing 5 guineas, he turned me off. Now, I never suspected he counted them.
Who do you look upon, madam, as your best sort of keepers?
For my part, I own I like an old fellow, for we always make them pay for what they cannot do.
But to be sure, sir, with so much good fortune as you have had upon the road, you must be grown immensely rich.
The gangsters and lawyers are jugglers alike. If they meddle, your all is in danger. The gangsters and lawyers are jugglers alike. If they meddle, your all is in danger. Like gypsies, if once they can finger a
thank you. know what is fittest for our prisoners. Whenever a gentleman uses me with civility, I always do the best I can to please him. Hand them down, I say! We have them of all prices, from 1 guinea to 10, and it's only fitting every gentleman should please himself.
I understand you, sir. The fees here are so many and so exorbitant that few fortunes can bear the expense of getting off handsomely, or of dying like a gentleman.
Had I the finest gentleman in the land in my custody, I could not equip him more handsomely. And so, sir, I now leave you to your private meditations.
This and my execution. But I promised the wench marriage. What signifies a promise to a woman? Does not man in marriage itself promise 100 things he never means to perform? Do all we can, women will believe us, for they look on a promise as a means for following their own inclinations.
You base man, you! How can you look me in the face after what has passed between us? See here, perfidious wretch, I am forced to bear about the load of infamy you have laid upon me. Oh, Macheath, thou hast robbed me of my quiet. To see thee tortured would give me pleasure.
Thus, when a good housewife sees a rat in her trap in the morning taken,
It is true. I go to the house. I chat with the girl. I kiss her. I say 100 things to her as all gentlemen do to divert myself. And now the silly jade had said it about that I married to her. Sure, my dear Lucy. These violent passions may be of ill consequence to someone in your condition.
Come, come, Captain. For all your assurance, you know Miss Polly hath put it out of your power to do me the justice you promised me.
The very first opportunity, if we can find the chaplain, I shall have no scruples of making you my wife. And I know the consequence of having two at a time.
Yonder is my father. Perhaps this way we may light upon the chaplain. Who shall try? If you will be as good as your word. For I long to be made an honest woman.
Help to change the scene, you rogues! Lend a hand, you traipsing, trolloping maypole, you! Lend a hand, whip! We represent another part of the prison. Stir yourself there!
In this last affair, Brother Petern, we are agreed. You have consented to go halves in McKeith.
We shall never fall out about an execution, but as to that last article, pray, how stands our last year's account?
If you will run your eye over it, you will see it is fair, clearly stated.
Ah, here's poor Ned Clincher's name, I see. To be sure, Brother Lockett, there was a little unfair proceeding in Ned's case, for he told me in the condemned hold that for value received, you had promised him a sessions or two longer without molestation.
Mr. Peacham, this is the first time my honor was ever called in question.
Business is at an end if once we act dishonorably.
Who accuses me?
You are born, brother.
He that attacks my honor attacks my livelihood, and this usage, sir, is not to be borne.
Since you provoke me to speak, I must tell you, too, that Mrs. Coaxer charges you with defrauding her of her information money for the apprehending of Curl Painted Hugh. Indeed, indeed, brother, we must punctually pay our spies, or we shall have no information.
Is this language to me, sir, who have saved you from the gallows, sir?
If I am to be hanged, it shall be for ridding the world of an errant rascal.
Oh, this hand shall do the office of the halter you deserve and throttle you, you dog!
Try me! You saddle goose!
You snap crap! Oh. Oh.
Brother! Oh, brother! We shall both be losers in the dispute. We are both in the wrong, and you know we have it in each other's power to hang each other. You should not be so passionate,
nor you so provoking.
It is in our best interest. It is in the interest of the world. We should agree. If I said anything, brother, to the prejudice of your character, I ask pardon. But now I must step home, for I expect a gentleman about this snuff box that Filch nimmed in the park 2 nights ago.
Whence come you, hussy?
My teeth might answer that question.
You have then been whimpering and fondling like a spaniel over that fellow that hath abused you.
One cannot help love. One cannot cure it. It is not in my power to obey you and hate him.
Learn to bear your husband's death like a reasonable woman. It is not so much the fashion nowadays as to affect sorrow on these occasions. Act like a woman of spirit, hussy, and thank your father for what he is doing.
I hang your husband.
So make yourself as easy as you can by getting all you can from him.
Oh, sir, my father's hard heart is not to be softened, and I'm in the utmost despair.
But if I could raise a small sum, would not 20 guineas think you move him? Money well timed and properly applied can do anything.
What love or money can do shall be done, for all my comfort depends upon your safety. Oh, where is my dear husband? Was there no better intended for this neck? Oh, let me throw my arms about it and throttle me with love. Oh, my king! I will stay with thee till death. No more shall turn my dear wife from thee now. What means my love? Not one kind word, not one kind look. Think what thy Polly suffers to see thee in this condition.
I must disown her. The witch is distracted.
Am I then balked of my virtue? Can I have no reparation? Sure, men were born to lie and women to believe them. Oh, villain, villain!
Am I not thy wife? Thy neglect of me, thy aversion to me too severely proves it. Look on me, tell me, am I not thy wife?
Perfidious wretch!
Barbarous husband!
Had thou been hanged 5 months ago, I had been happy.
And I too!
Art thou then married to one another? Hast thou two wives, monster?
If women's tongues can cease for an answer, hear me.
I will not publish it, but I bear my
name. Shall I not claim my own justice against me speak?
A happy could I be with either more tundered and charmer away. But why if this takes me together to neither a word will I say. But tundra, 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 but why if this takes me together to neither a word will I say. Neither a word will I say.
Thank you.
show you the door. I'm sorry, madam. You forced me to be so ill-bred.
Give me leave to tell you, madam. These four chairs do not become you in the least, madam. And my duty, madam, obliges me to stay with my husband, madam.
Lucy, my education.
temptation might have put thee more upon thy guard, for the girl in the bar of an alehouse is always besieged.
Dear sir, mention not my education, for with that I owe my ruin.
Intends to outwit me in this affair. But I will be even with him. The dog is leaky in his liquor, so I will ply him that way, get the secret from him, and turn this affair to my own advantage. I'll go to him at his lock, artfully get into his secret, so that Macheath will remain not a day longer out of my clutches.
Oh,
dine like honest tradesmen ought to have a fair trial with justice and all rich the other.
Viper, vile toad, shame on thee, Beelzebub. Fly with us now from Newgate's jail. Away, away, follow my keep to Marlborough. Our scene doth represent a gay meeting house, lords and fine gentlemen at play, women too.
That hath been tried.
we let her enter, Brother Locket?
By all means, she is a good customer and a fine-spoken woman. And a woman who drinks and talks lively will enliven the conversation.
Desire her to walk in. Ah, dear Mrs. Dye, your servant. Oh, one may know by your kiss, madam, that your gin is excellent.
I was always very curious in my liquors.
There is no perfumed breath like it. I have long been acquainted with the flavor of those lips, have I not, Mrs. Dye?
Fill it up. I take as large drafts of liquor as I did of love. And I hate a flincher in either.
Thank you.
and so many die of that naturally that I shall never be called into question. But say I were to be hanged, I never could be hanged for anything that would give me greater comfort than the poisoning of that slut.
Ah, oh, madam! Here is our Miss Polly come to wait upon you.
Show her in. Dear madam, your servant. I hope you'll pardon my passion when I was so happy to see you last. I was so overrun with the spleen that I was perfectly out of myself. I wish all our quarrels might have so comfortable a reconciliation. Miss Polly, by way of friendship, will you give me leave to propose a glass of cordial to you?
Strong waters are apt to give me the headache. I hope, madam, you will excuse me.
Not the greatest lady in the land could have better in her closet for her own private drinking. You seem mighty low in spirits, my dear.
I am sorry, madam. My health will not allow me to accept of your offer. I should not have left you in the rude manner I did when we met last, madam, had not my papa hauled me away so unexpectedly. But really, madam, the captain treated me with so much contempt and cruelty that I deserved your pity rather than your resentment.
But since his escape, no doubt all matters are made up again. Ah, Polly, Polly, 'tis I am the unhappy wife, and he loves you as if you were only his mistress.
Sure, madam, you cannot make me so happy as to be the object of your jealousy. A man is always afraid of a woman who loves him too well, so that I must expect to be neglected and avoided.
Then our cases, my dear Polly, are exactly alike. We both indeed have been too fond.
A curse attends a woman's love, who always would be pleasing, a witness of the feeling dove.
With me, thou hadst been safe.
between your two widows.
Which way shall I turn me? How can I decide? As a day of a heart and bar as fun as a bride. One wife is too much for most husbands to bear, but two at a time there's no more to prepare. Each way and that way, each way I owe, what would comfort the what other wife would take in? Each way and that way, each way I owe, what would comfort the what other wife would take in?
What if his own misfortunes have made him insensible to mine? A father sure will be more compassionate. Dear, dear sir, seek the material evidence and bring him off at his trial. Polly upon her knees begs it of you.
Time has come, Lucy. We know our own affairs, so let's have no more of this whimpering and whining. Ourselves like a great to secure.
Ourselves like a great to secure a retreat.
When matters require.
When matters
must
require.
Must be bargained. And good reason why.
And some reason why.
Sir, to conduct you. you to the Old Bailey.
So I drink of this bumper, and now I can stand the test.
from prison, you see, gentlemen. I'm ordered immediate execution. The sheriff's officers, I believe, are now at the door. That Jimmy Tweecher should peach me, I own, surprised me. It is a plain proof that the world is all alike, and that even our gang can no more trust one another than other people. Therefore, I beg you, gentlemen, look well to yourselves, for in all probability you may live some months longer.
We are heartily sorry, Captain, for your misfortune, but it is what we must all come to.
Peachum and Lockett, you know, are infamous scoundrels. Their lives are as much in your power as yours are in theirs. Remember your dying friend. It is my last request. See those villains to the gallows before you, and I am satisfied.
We will do it.
Miss Polly and Miss Lucy entreat a word with you.
Gentlemen. My dear Lucy. My dear Polly. Whatsoever hath passed between us is now at an end. If either of you are fond of marrying again, the best advice I can give you is to ship yourselves off for the West Indies. There you'll have a fair chance of getting a husband apiece, or two or three as you like best.
Oh!
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 It would have shown that the lower to well evoke his desire.